Welcome to the Institute of Advanced Legal Studies in London. My name is Carl Stichen, and I'm the Director of IELTS. It's my pleasure to welcome you today to the Director's Series of Seminars, a monthly remote event on the Institute calendar. Thank you for joining us. It's my great pleasure today to welcome remotely to the Institute Dr. Ruth Fletcher. Ruth is a member of the School of Law at Queen Mary University of London, where she teaches and researches on medical law. More specifically, Ruth's research addresses the relationship between law, health, and society through the lens of reproduction. She has an ongoing interest in law's reproductivity, the generation of new legal forms through the synthesis of already existing legal forms. Her research is also concerned with the practical, everyday ways in which health, sexuality, and reproduction become objects of legal struggle. Much of her work in this area has focused on documenting and critiquing the kinds of arguments and strategies that are generated in the regulation of abortion. Finally, Ruth is interested in reproduction as a key site of law and gender. She is co-investigator of the AHRC Revaluing Care Network, an international interdisciplinary network which aims to create spaces for dialogue about care across a range of contexts. Ruth's paper today is entitled Finding Time in Abortion Law. She will speak for about 40 minutes, and questions can be raised by our audience members in the Q&A function at any time. I will then attempt to moderate the questions in the discussion period. The seminar is scheduled for 90 minutes. Closed captioning should be available at the bottom of your screen. Welcome, Ruth. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Carl, and a big thank you to you and to Dali and everybody at IELTS for creating the Director Seminar Series, and I'm very much looking forward to having a chance to present this work in progress and to engaging with your audience later. So with this work, Finding Time in Abortion Law, I see it primarily, it's a moment, I guess, in a larger project where I'm trying to contribute to reproductive justice, the theorization and the fleshing out practically of the theory of reproductive justice, partly because our legal methods and forms in that in reproductive justice still tend to rely on rights predominantly. And so while Black feminist work around reproductive justice has been phenomenal in the kind of impact it's made in showing us the connections between abortions regulation and all sorts of other areas of life and making life-generating matters central to legal and social justice study more generally, I think I want to build on what the repeal movement and the global reproductive justice movement more generally, to build on what they've done in terms of holding legal forms to account. And so I'm trying to think about developing time tools then as a kind of sociolegal form that would help with holding rights and other tools of legal authority to account. So that's one way, I think, to understand what I'm doing today. And then the other way in which this paper might be situated is to think, I'm trying to think as well about abortion law as a site of social reproduction, how, and trying to think then about how the generation of time itself, how that can be a category that helps us to see the way that abortion law manages the value of reproductive labor more generally. So with those two frameworks in mind, I'll get on with presenting this paper. The periodization of gestational time has become a key means of justifying differential terms for the lawful withdrawal of gestational labor. A block of 12, 14, 16, 18 calendar weeks often secures the lawfulness of abortion on request in many jurisdictions around the globe, and most recently in Ireland since 2018. Calendar time, then, measured in weeks, has become an abstract means of facilitating the majority of abortion seekers in achieving their objectives, while also providing some space for slippage. Using time to mark out abortion's lawfulness in this way seems to be saying something about how time spent in gestational labour is valued. Accessing abortion outside these calendared time periods typically requires some other condition, some other lawful condition to be met, such as a risk of health. Grounds for legal access, such as an emergency, a risk to a woman's healthy future, or limits on access, such as fetal viability or medical approval, are also informed by concepts of time, but just not explicitly the time of calendar weeks. The time of these grounds, then, is measured by reference to a pregnant person's future prognosis, to fetal development, or to professional expertise. But the impact over the last 50 years of a periodic model of abortion law, which measures pregnant time in trimesters and in weeks, shows how time itself has become an explicit criterion of abortion's regulation on its own terms. The role of calendar weeks, then, in justifying the variability in the terms of lawful abortion access tells us something about the legal significance of time spent in gestational labour. Lawyers and researchers typically identify the time of abortion law as a matter of procedural significance, time limits as processes, technical processes, or we sometimes see them talked about as having a role in securing pragmatic compromise between competing and conflicting substantive interests. Or we see them talked about in the scholarship as a barrier to access. How do these different approaches help us see how time works in abortion law? Those who have thought about time limits and waiting periods as procedural criteria show us the key role of timely requirements as they move people along in accessing abortion care. This moving along may not receive as much attention as substantive criteria, but it is vital to the working of law nonetheless. As abortion may be legally categorized as on request in terms of its substantive framing, but operationalizing that request may require a certification that the person accessing it is no more than 12 weeks pregnant. So time limits and waiting periods then present an opportunity to engage what Joanna Erdman, following Wendy Brown, has called the anti-politics of legal instruments. The depoliticized and apparently technical nature of timely requirements makes them an excellent site to investigate what Erdman has called the complex and contradictory ways in which the anti-politics of global abortion are themselves a powerful political force. When time limits are represented as the result of political and legal compromise that has been brokered between different constituencies, they become visible as political artifact, as objects which can be found in law as the result of political labour. Reva Segal explains how the presence of a time limit, such as 12 weeks, in the on-request framework for abortion performs the role of reassurance then, for some of the discontented in the struggle for reproductive justice. The time limit becomes a placeholder for those concerned about legal respect for fetal life, and it operates as a check on the pregnant people who have been permitted to access abortion for their own reasons. For Segal, time limits are a legal means to secure compromise between rival claims. Even if they are the result of compromise, then this way of thinking about time limits makes visible the political labour which reproduce them. As political artifacts, then, we might think of time limits holding that labour within themselves and keeping a legal infrastructure in place. Other scholars have been gathering information and evidence about how time limits work as concrete barriers to access. Desordo, Zanini, and other colleagues have identified that gestational time limits on abortion are the primary reason why pregnant people travel to other jurisdictions in Europe in order to access abortion. So their work then pushes scholars to move beyond the characterization of timely criteria as secondary barriers. There typically have been talked about as secondary barriers, different from a risk to health. Instead, then, we need to think more about how legal requirements of gestational time come to work as primary modes of regulating pregnant people. Seeing time limits, then, as process, as compromise and barrier provides a rich stepping off point for exploring further and considering what a focus on timely components might help us find in abortion law. So if we change perspective slightly as we look at these legal time limits and political artifacts, what might we see? How is the time of time limits? How is it materialized? How is it measured? What kind of timeliness does the time limit want from its legal subjects? How do timely requirements expect people to feel? Such questions then might help us see something more than law as the procedural result of compromise between opposing factions, a compromise which may come to operate as a barrier to lives lived before the law. By understanding more about how time is measured, how it's prescribed, and how it's felt in legal time limits and other timely requirements such as mandatory waiting periods, we can learn more about the generation of reproductive value, and we can make visible the possibility of rearrangement. This paper then draws on scholarship on and around the interface between law, time, and social reproduction in order to suggest possible lines of sight for asking and answering these kinds of questions. I differentiate between material time, normative timeliness, and atmospheric temporality as different dimensions that allow us to see complexity in the relationship between law and time. I show how each dimension can be seen to do different, if interconnected, work in managing and making gestational time in Ireland's four new lawful pathways to abortion care. So these four pathways then, just before I go on, just to try and give people a sense of the practical content of the four pathways that have been adopted in Ireland since the removal of the constitutional amendment which prevented abortion, and since the adoption of new abortion legislation in 2018, it's brought Ireland into the regime of periodic abortion law, which makes abortion lawful. And so we have, first of all, the first pathway is that of lawfulness in the first 12 weeks. And that has that time there has to be certified by a doctor. And there's also a mandatory three-day waiting period. The second pathway is that of risk of serious harm to health or to life. And that has to be certified as well, but that's by two doctors. And there's a cutoff point of fetal viability. The third pathway is also a risk of serious harm to health or a risk to life, but that's in an emergency context. And that emergency context means it's certified by one doctor and fetal viability does not operate as a cutoff point. And then we have the fetus-centric grounds, a condition likely to lead to death of a fetus, but that's within 28 days of birth. So in thinking about what we find then as we look at the regulation of these four different pathways as an example of periodic abortion law, then, first of all, I want to talk about material time, how the time is being counted through these pathways, how it's being counted and measured. Much of the work on law and time over the last 30 years or so sets itself against an understanding of time as an empty dimension through which law passes. Rather, scholars such as Greenhouse, Emily Grabham, Carol Greenhouse, Emily Grabham, Sarah Keenan are interested in exploring the different ways that time is made in, across, and up against law. This account of time as a lively thing that is made in the world is one sense in which time is material. Time is made out of existing entities. There is labor that goes into that making, and that making will generate new time, even as that new time bears the traces of its ancestors. Across different approaches to how time matters for law and legal relations, we can see that time's material periodization, it measures with a variety of timely components and processes. These timely processes include clock and rhythmic time, and they use bodily, social, and environmental resources in moving things along. Scholars who have been attracted to timely effects and the micro practices of time, partly they've been attracted to those questions, I think, because the older materialist way of thinking about time as it contributes to social injustice tended to work in broader sweeps as it searched for patterns in systems and institutions. But if feminist and other critical approaches are to work with a non-binary perspective on dimensions of social reproduction and reproductive justice, then working across different materialist perspectives without flattening the differences seemed desirable. So I'm interested in watching for how micro practices of time, as they circulate in documents, in technicalities, in parts, watching for those and thinking about them in light of the orders, systems and wholes that organize the value and time of reproductive life. If we think about them in light of each other, we might discover something interesting about the way gestational time itself is measured, but also how it's valued in law. Ireland's recent adoption of a periodic abortion law then presents an opportunity to examine how gestational time is measured as the different pathways to abortion care are legally articulated. When law provides that you can only have an abortion if your pregnancy is no more than 12 weeks along, or if the future child you're carrying cannot survive any longer than 28 days after birth, it's not simply letting time pass. Rather, law marks out particular periods of time, fills them with particular meanings, and fits them together to make some kind of a whole infrastructure as it declares the terms on which gestational time will count and as it enables the withdrawal of gestational labour. These four different pathways are produced through the coming together of statutory provisions, pregnant people's abortion practices, through gynecological measurement, through hospital and GP management protocols, as the timely delivery of abortion becomes an everyday reality. But some are more used than others, and the vast majority of notified abortions since the legislation was adopted use the 12-week ground. The fetal anomaly ground is the next most used legal pathway, with the risk to health and the emergency grounds only being used in a tiny handful of cases. So how do each of these pathways count gestational time? The early pathway is measured by the 12-week period of lawfulness then, but that begins with the first day of a woman's last menstrual period and is counted out in calendar weeks, a counting which increasingly relies on the inflexible time of the clock to mark the end point, but sometimes uses biomedical time of fetal development in professional guidance documents, for example. So the adoption of calendar weeks as a way of measuring gestational time builds on periodic law and its adherence to a trimester framework for differentiating legal criteria for access to abortion. The move to calendar weeks as the unit of legal measurement is one that repeats that adopted in other parts of the world, as this innovation from the 1970s uses trimesters and calendar weeks to mark out different periods of abortion's lawfulness. This legal move pushes back against legal scrutiny of a woman's reasons for needing to withdraw from pregnancy, and it pushes back against fetal development as the key marker of gestational time. In doing so, it makes gestational time abstract in useful and not so useful ways, and it generates a new legal form, I would say, of calendared gestational time limit. So this calendar time period of 12 weeks, it explicitly draws on, in the statute itself, cyclical time, since the starting point for the 12-week clock begins on the first day of the woman's last menstrual period. The clock then is triggered by a concrete event in a way which centers the pregnant person's body and acknowledges rhythmic time in its use of a bodily cycle to count beginnings. This bodily cycle is both natural and social, not one nor the other exclusively, since menstrual rhythms ebb and flow in interaction with the body's need for nourishment, rest, and shelter. But this way of counting gestational time from a menstrual beginning has come to matter in law because of its clinical use. So because it's the clinical point of reference, that's how it's come to have dominance in the statute. Nevertheless, the presence of in law of cyclical time as the time of gestational beginnings is significant and provides a material resource which timely tools could rework then. Ireland's law requires certification that the 12-week deadline has been met in a move which reinstates medical professionals as the authorizers of access. And that process of certification itself weighs professional and pregnant time, as the threat of criminal sanction hangs over medical certifiers, but not over pregnant women. If a pregnant person misses that 12-week deadline, they only qualify for abortion provision if their circumstances meet the criteria for one or more of the other legal pathways. Some will travel either because they do not meet those criteria or because they want to avoid putting themselves through the process of finding out. But the second non-calendar weekly pathway, then, the risk to health life orientated pathway, in adopting this, the periodic abortion law is taking an older and a more familiar mechanism in some ways for making abortion lawful, but it's reproducing it anew. And it's reproducing it in relation to the calendared 12-week pathway. This risk to health ground recognizes that the passing of gestational time may impose significant costs on a pregnant person's reproductive body, directly and indirectly. Securing her living future may require her becoming unpregnant. This ground quantifies the threshold for pregnant repair in terms of a risk of serious harm to health or a risk of death. So a gestational period of illness, of unhealthy time, which is likely to result in serious harm to her health or in loss of her life, is the kind of time that has been measured here. We can still think about it in terms of categories of time, but it's just not abstract calendar time. The risk to health ground is not abstract time, but material time that counts because of its unhealthiness. People will need to use this pathway precisely because they failed to access the calendared pathway. And so this way of counting time, it's placing alongside the calendared pathway, helps us to think about the infrastructure as a whole and means that in effect, it runs sequentially after the calendared pathway, even though there's no reason to think that it couldn't run synchronously. The problem here from the user's point of view is that the threshold is set relatively high, since there has to be a risk to life or a risk of serious harm to health before intervention is legally justified. And that threshold is judged by medics and not by the woman or pregnant person herself. So this sort of statutory provision and the way it's been implemented restrictively in Ireland requires that the gestational qualifying period is certified by two doctors. And the question of what qualifies as an illness or condition that generates a risk of serious harm is made a matter for medical professionals then, not for pregnant people. So this repeats the requirement of professional certification performed in the early pathway. But whereas the early pathway, the certification is in relation to timeliness, now it becomes in relation to the risk to health. It demands more professional time quantitatively, and it also requires a qualitatively different kind of professional time, since one practitioner must be an obstetrician. The third pathway, the emergency period of gestational time that qualifies for an abortion under Section 10 in the Irish legislation and other similar emergency provisions throughout the world, it's generated by legal recognition that pregnancy can become a moment of crisis. So that sort of sense of crisis time. Such legal moments of crisis have the material effect of lessening the amount and kind of professional time needed to certify approval, and they render the cutoff point of fetal viability irrelevant. This legal pathway overlaps with the risk to health pathway, the unhealthy time pathway, in counting a risk to health with professional diagnosis, but the risk must pose an immediate danger necessitating intervention. And so women's health counts throughout pregnancy here, but only when things have got so bad that rescuing the pregnant person's health requires immediate intervention. And this means that it's more likely to take the form of an authoritarian type intervention, responding to necessity and emergency, one which pays little attention to the words of the pregnant person themselves. The fourth gestational period of time that the statute counts is one which is measured by reference to likely fetal death and the predicted absence of a future for the fetus or the neonate. So this periodization is interesting here because it pushes the event of birth away as the usual marker of the end of the relevant gestational process, because here the likelihood of death is measured by reference to neonatal registers and 28 days after birth. The practitioner is required to assess the future likelihood of fetal or neonatal death on the basis of diagnostic information available to her in the here and now about the condition of pregnancy. But likelihood of fetal death becomes the key frame for measuring a fetal future, and the moment of future death has been given that 28 days range. Clinicians responding to that have to respond to that then by trying to diagnose types of conditions which are likely to have these consequences. But the question becomes how likelihood then, so it's diagnostic likelihood becomes the key measuring tool in this context. And we know that there is considerable evidence that the way in which likelihood of no reproductive future, likelihood of fetal death, the way that is being measured is looking for virtual certainty of death rather than a more civil law type standard of more likely than not to happen. And so that's one way in which we can rework the likelihood criterion as it's being currently measured and operationalized in a way which is denying people access in practice. And then, of course, we could try and think about how we might further mobilize a sociolegal standard of likelihood that allows the chance of fetal death to register as a significant moment and not just requiring the kind of 50% plus one type likelihood. This consideration then of four periods of gestational time that are recognized as qualifying a pregnant person for an abortion shows us that there are various material processes: calendaring weekly pregnancy, reducing risks to health and life, immediate intervention, diagnosing likelihood. These are the processes then which have become legally relevant for counting gestational time. Figuring out how to best work with legal time does not at all in the statute privilege the clock over the calendar, nor does it require abandoning cyclical time in favor of clock time. Rather, making the best of the legal time, which is given effect through periodic abortion law, ought to require thinking about the sequencing and the synchronization of time as this collection of material resources and processes that work across production and reproduction, that work across clock and calendar, gestational and caring labor. So our first collection then, we have a collection of time limits, artifacts in law, which mark calendar cyclical time, which mark a kind of reparative risk reduction time and an immediate intervention. But they also have this diagnosing of likelihood as a type of material process. So that's the first kind of collection of time limits turned time tools that we might be able to use more critically. The second category is that of normative timeliness. And so it's about how those material, how the material processes then, how they generate expectations of human behavior and how that becomes explicit through norms of what's expected from timeliness then. So normative timeliness gathers together the different ways in which law comes to prescribe some behaviours over others, as it calls for punctuality, as it calls for improvement or progression over time, as it calls for urgency or speed or sometimes slowness, as it calls for careful speculation about the future and investment in future time. Concern over the appropriate use of precious time has made timeliness an important goal in everyday life, in law and in institutional practice. But typically, timeliness tends to be considered by medical law and related scholarship as a kind of normative obligation that we impose administratively on the state and less at the level of regulating individual behaviour. As scholars of time show us, however, timeliness may work to stigmatize and to discipline certain reproductive practices. Whether the moving along of time achieves goals such as punctuality, improvement, continuity, change, whether it achieves speed in the legal ordering of pregnancy, these all give us different senses then of normative timeliness. There's timeliness is emerging as a goal which has to be certified, but there are different senses of timeliness available in the law. This legal variety means that we get a mix of what Davina Cooper calls normative temporalities. We get this mixture at work. And sometimes that raises challenges about cohesive working of the law, for sure, but it also gives us intersections and mixtures that we can redeploy anew. One of the puzzles for periodic abortion laws, then, for medical legal scholars, has been the apparent depiction of an early abortion as something normatively better than a later abortion, and the way that early-late distinction has come into being. Typically, medical legal scholars point out that the 12-week deadline is not normatively justified because there's nothing about the pregnancy at that point that justifies more or less restrictions on the pregnant person. So this is the type of scholarship that problematizes then a gradualist perspective on pregnancy and sees it as nothing more than a compromise, and doesn't see it as something substantive in itself. Apart from the fact that compromises, though, are more than empty instruments, right? I'm seeing them as the results of political labor, as bearing traces of these different conceptions of time. This position, I would say, this critique of the gradualist perspective, it overinvests in fetal development as the marker of a justifiable qualitative difference. It's assuming fetal development as the reason why the early-late distinction shouldn't matter. But the 12-week marker, we can understand it as having normative significance for other reasons. We could argue that it has come to be a significant marker in abortion because women and pregnant people's abortion practice has made it a significant marker. If women decide that continuing to grow embryonic or fetal life in their bodies is not the right thing to do, typically they will seek out a termination of pregnancy at the earliest possible point. The longer a pregnancy continues, the greater its cost on the pregnant person as gestation tires and depletes the reproductive body. So 12-week time limits are not simply arbitrary points picked in the name of compromise between different constituencies. They mark an approximate time by which most pregnant people have ended their pregnancy, if they can, if it's available to them. By turning that social and moving point of 12 weeks into a legal deadline, by shoring it up as a legal deadline, the statute is taking legal action when none is necessary, when action is not necessary. There's no need to achieve the incentivization of earliness, we might argue. The adoption of a legal norm of punctuality as earliness makes failure to achieve that norm into a kind of punishment. So that's the reliance on more difficult pathways. That's becoming the form of punishment rather than the criminal law here. So that form of punishment is problematic then in regulating this earliness. So in Ireland's periodic abortion law, how has it adopted the 12-week period of lawfulness as a norm guiding behaviour? Partly its legal instruction to be early is constituted in law by making this 12-week deadline strict and inflexible. So here we see where it moves from a calendar time approach to a clock approach. And the 12 weeks is measured not as 12 weeks and 6 days, as can be the approach in other jurisdictions, but as 12 week and 0 days. And so the chief medical officer has taken a very blunt, inflexible clock time approach to the 12 week deadline. So that's one way in which we see the institutional interpretation not deliver on the calendar time approach and instead see an inflexible clock approach. A second way in which we see
the move away from a calendar time approach with the early deadline and the kind of enforcement of a fixed, inflexible deadline is the way in which failed abortions have been interpreted. So if a woman, if her medical abortion, for example, fails, and there's typically about 1% is estimated will fail to achieve the abortion when drugs are used, then that the clock is not run from the time the abortion started, but the pregnancy clock of 12 weeks continues through that abortion time. And if she goes over the 12-week deadline while she's having the medical abortion, but that is fails, she's not allowed to stop the clock and access abortion even though it's failed. And so that's, again, an interpretation of a not taking the stopping of the clock as a possibility with the overlaying of the new reproductive procedure here in terms of abortion care, medical abortion having an impact on the delivery. So those are two examples of, I would say, the wrong statutory approach in a way has been the calendar approach has not been delivered institutionally. And practically, we can speak back with a calendar form of time rather than the clock form of time. The second kind of timeliness then is constituted by the risk to health or life ground. And the normative goal there is human repair, right? It's repair of the depleted, sick, ill body. And so the adoption of a risk to health type criterion there does not see reproductive time's normative value in terms of punctuality and earliness, right? But in terms of progression and improvement through repair of the pregnant person. So that's where therapeutic grounds for lawful abortion recognize that pregnancy depletes a pregnant body and may contribute to ill health directly or indirectly as a result, even to the point of becoming a threat to the pregnant woman's life. The question then becomes, so this approach allows us to think about what kind of threshold of depletion and damage is recognized as justifying exit from gestational labor. And the problem with this, so there's a benefit at one level in the sense that it does recognize the need for reparative time. But the problem is that the threshold for entry to that reparative time as a normative justification for access is too high and too difficult. And so we have very few cases going through, and it's also cut off in rather blunt fashion by reference to fetal viability. The legal norm of timeliness is constituted as urgency then. So a third way in which normative timeliness is understood through the recognition of an immediate necessity of the intervention. And so that's where necessity, again, it's a mobilization of exceptionality, which can be very useful. But again, it's being constructed in narrow and authoritarian terms. So the urgent timeliness of a now moment emerges to organize abortion as the lawful response when the pregnant person herself needs help in reproducing her own life. The recognition that abortion is legally permissible because a future of parenting is or has become unsupportable is another way in which norms of timeliness then as a supportable future have a legal impact. The normative timeliness of urgency pushes away these legal restrictions which accompany the conventional risk to health pathway, the second doctor certification and the fetal viability limit go, but it's a legal urgency which is more likely to be expressed in authoritarian terms, which squeeze out the voice of the pregnant person. The fourth stage then allows access to abortion on terms which endorse a norm of timely speculation about reproductive futures. So here it's drawing out the way in which that fourth pathway, it's not just about diagnosing and counting the likelihood of fetal death, but it does actually recognize a norm of investment in a reproductive future and allowing people to speculate to some extent about that reproductive future. And so that's an interesting and potentially useful normative commitment. But it's because the only speculative future that counts in order for access to abortion is one where is a fetus-centric one, and one where the loss of fetal life has to be made virtually certain. That's the limiting then of the normative, an opening up of normative space for speculative futures. So the underdevelopment then of the non-calendar pathways, the reparative pathway, the immediate urgency pathway, the speculative reproductive future pathway, these are there in you know, they are traces of them are there in the law, but they're underdeveloped. And through that underdevelopment, they become difficult means of access, and they become then, they work in the overall holistic legal infrastructure as a form of punishment in a way for not be accessing the early category of abortion. And so that leaves us with a collection of norms of timeliness. We do have different norms of timeliness around punctuality and earliness, around repair, urgency, and speculative future. And, you know, perhaps we can just rebalance the ways in which those norms are being articulated and grow some of the traces in more creative ways. The third collection then comes from the atmospheric temporality, the way in which this speaks to temporality as a felt legal arrangement, an emotional, affective set of experiences in space. And so abortion law has long been analysed for its power to carry an atmosphere of disapproval for pregnant people's reproductive self-management. And so Erica Miller is an example of somebody more recently who has shown us how the depiction of abortion as a tragedy gets in the way of recognizing the possibility of happy abortions, and how it produces the aborting woman as an effect alien, she says. So one of the significant contributions of this scholarship on law, affect, emotion, and atmosphere has been an appreciation of how visceral, embodied responses, how they move people along, how they contribute to our sense of being in time. So rather than regard felt responses to law and worldly actions as something that's tamed by reason, scholarship on affect and emotion has encouraged us to see the different ways that felt responses tell us something about law, whether that's conscious or reasonable or not. It's not asking that kind of a question. So someone like Valverde, for example, she's speaking to the way that time is felt and how it generates atmosphere, how the feeling of time in space generates atmosphere as time takes on flesh and as it charges space. And it's this charging then, using a register of feelings that that range across the pre-conscious visceral responses and conscious emotional responses to harsh or happy situations. So we know then that the criminal legal form, right, participated in the generation of a harsh atmosphere for pregnant women who did not find pregnancy supportable for different kinds of reasons and in different circumstances. By personifying the fetus in pregnancy in the 18th century through the criminalization of abortion, right, that global legal development, it was about arranging for the withdrawal of gestational labor to be treated with contempt. It was calling for that reaction to this way of managing reproduction. So while that criminal legal form meant that some reproductive futures were prioritized over others, criminal law also had defenses and justifications which enabled exceptional disapplication of the criminal offense in certain circumstances, such as when an unhealthy reproductive future threatened a woman's life. But now that we have decriminalization of women and partial decriminalization of supporters of gestational labors, what kind of atmospheric legality is being generated as abortion law is less criminalized, if not completely decriminalized, and as it's managed through time-limited pathways? Well, one thing that we do see is we do see Ireland's periodic abortion law and other similar laws. We do see them contributing to a relief producing infrastructure, that the emotional response of relief is the top emotional response that is typically reported empirically. And so this idea of abortion law being supportive and facilitatory and of achieving relief for gestational laborers is a significant accomplishment and a significant resource within the law. The effects of the time-limited routinization of abortion care, though, are uneven in production of that relief because of other problems which the time limit brings. The generation of a time-limited pathway of access then anticipates that some will not meet the time limit, and therefore it generates a pressure to meet the deadline. And so that's generating then the deadline is brought forward, and we see an atmosphere of pressure an atmosphere of pressurized earliness. So the norm of earliness gets translated into an atmosphere of pressure, and that makes access uneven because this 12-week clause is used in a heavy-handed way, including through relying on the other pathways as forms of punishment. So pressure is also generated apart from the sort of clock approach to the deadline and apart from the not seeing the overlapping processes of abortion and pregnancy. We also see the imposition of a mandatory waiting period of 3 days. That's another way in which pressure is generated. Right at the deadline, you're slowed down and told that you have to reflect on what you're doing. And so mandatory waiting periods slow the process down at a point when pregnant women are up against the deadline, and they remind them that the pace of withdrawal from gestational labour is not under their own control. So the implementation of the 12-week deadline then has seen the chief medical officer use an inflexible clock approach where 12 weeks is interpreted as 12 weeks plus 0 days, when a more flexible calendar approach is more consistent with the statute. And in practice, the triggering of an abortion within the 12-week time limit has not managed to replace the abortion time, does not replace the temporality of pregnancy, and the woman is held still to the running of clock time from the moment that the 12 weeks was begun, the 12-week counting period was begun. So is this, as a result, then the possibility of being denied relief through missing the 12-week deadline that generates this added pressure to be early, a pressure which is kept in place by these difficulties then with the operation of the deadline. The second pathway to abortion, the risk to health one, it's generating an atmosphere of vulnerability, I would say, in the sense that we see how the overlap of time spent ill and how that the overlap of time spent in illness with gestational time, it's recognized as a legitimate circumstance for the withdrawal of gestational labor. So there is that recognition there, but its usefulness is that it is a pathway which has potential to become a legal pathway of bodily repair and bodily redress, and to recognize that depleted reproductive bodies need to be able to restore themselves to circumstances of unpregnancy. But the problem is that it has only been opened for those whose doctors say they are seriously ill. So it exacerbates vulnerability then. And so that's the atmosphere that's being generated, one of exacerbated vulnerability that is created by the legal requirements in relation to this repair ground. But it could be otherwise. And then finally, the condition likely to lead to the death of the fetus-centric ground, the way that we see it build on diagnostic likelihood and speculation about a neonatal future, that generates an atmosphere of futility and an atmosphere of hopelessness, because the only reproductive future that is recognized is one where the fetus is going to die, and there has to be a virtual certainty about that. So rather than it open up an atmosphere of hopefulness about reproductive futures, we see the only sort of emotional affective response that counts is one of futility and one of hopelessness. And so that is that atmosphere has restricted the and made it a traumatic experience again in terms of trying to access this pathway. So just to conclude then, time-related criteria have become key features of abortion law, but they tend to be assessed as processes, as compromises and barriers, rather than seeing them as moving substances which themselves contribute to abortion law as a site of social reproduction. As scholars of time have shown us, time is a key legal category as it works through law to organise our labour and practical human activity, to guide our behaviour and to make us feel better or worse about these circumstances. If we let these concerns for time's materials, norms and atmospheres guide our inquiry into abortion law's use of gestational time, what do we find? We find a kind of legal time then which draws on a collection of materials, a collection that includes bodily cycles, social rhythms, and scheduled clocks. These materials are currently arranged in a way which incentivizes early use and subjects later use to scrutiny and to stigma and shame. But other arrangements are also visible in the law, and they could be foregrounded more. Grown and supported in their development. So a time-related approach to abortion law then has the benefit of centering she who spends gestational time in pregnancy and identifying multiple different ways in which that time is counted, in which it's valued, in which it's arranged. This facilitates engagement, perhaps, in rearranging at the micro level, moments of time, at the meso level institutionally, as well as macro ways in terms of the legal framework and funded support. Law already has the components then for building an abortion infrastructure, which would recognize that gestational time ought not be extracted without return, that spending gestational time depletes and it requires repair. But more than that, finding a collection of timely tools in law that could reproduce the value of reproductive labor anew, that also provides us more generally with a set of timely legal tools and concepts, which build an alternative to the idea of the all-conquering time machine. If we think of plural legal tools, multiple legal tools as working at the micro level, that can allow us to think about, to move away from the time machine in Wells's version as something that is a conquering movement through time and space. So we can think about, developing time limits as artifacts that can become timely tools for recrafting law. And this, I think, works with a kind of compositional and fractal way of thinking about law that's accountable to everyday realities, that take seriously the composite way that people engage with law and the sort of multidimensional fractal way that Denise Ferreira da Silva talks about, the multidimensionality of our legal experiences. And so there's different ways that we can draw on that multidimensionality as we use timely tools then to build for a future world of valued reproducers, ways in which we could use the tools to move the furniture around and make exiting gestation a more comfortable possibility for gestational labours. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Ruth, for a really deeply textured, fantastic paper. And I'd invite our audience members at any point to send their questions in through the Q&A function, and I will try to moderate them. But I want to use the chair's prerogative to begin. I mean, there were lots of really fascinating points in the paper. But I mean, one thing sprung to mind early on when you're talking about time as having a procedural significance in law. And I was reading about the recent Supreme Court case in the US on abortion law. And apparently one comment from the Chief Justice, one question was, well, if pregnancy has these, you know, negative consequences to the pregnant person and the pregnant person's body, why would it take so much time to make a decision to terminate? And that seemed to be such a particular kind of legal notion of time, almost the way we would think of it in the context of a warranty, that you have to make a decision within this particular period of time. And why would it take so long if this wasn't what you wanted? And I wonder if that rang true for the in the research you were doing.
Yeah. That's so interesting. Absolutely. I mean, as you say, this idea of time as a warranty, or the way that question is asked, is a very, like, thinking about that time then, that pregnant time, and deciding that you don't want to continue the pregnancy, as if, you know, that decision or that experience is happening on one plane of human activity, as if there's nothing else going on in the pregnant person's life that is having an impact on how they make that decision. So, yeah, it really illustrates this idea that, that, you know, decisions about pregnancy, that as if it's an expectation, I guess, of decisions about pregnant life and reproductive life, as if they aren't layered, as if they aren't needing to figure out how to get time off work, how to organize childcare, you know, all the everyday kind of components that go in, as if there might, you know, often, like for most people, there isn't a sense of ambivalence. They're very clear about what they want to do, but operationalizing what they want to do is complicated for lots of people. So, yeah, it kind of illustrates a very one-dimensional understanding of reproductive time, I suppose I would say.
Yeah, I mean, what was also interesting that I had never really thought about in these terms until I listened to you, was the way in which we have these two uses of time. On the one hand, time limits, and on the other hand, mandatory waiting periods of time. And it's almost like these two forms of time are kind of squeezing in on the ability, the time, to actually make a decision and have a termination.
Yeah, it's so interesting, isn't it? Because, yeah, so it's all about this pacing, isn't it? It's like, so the way the control and the discipline is being experienced is, yeah, there's these blocking of periods that you're, you know, allowed to manage your productive and reproductive life by, you know, hurrying up and having your abortion within 12 weeks. And, you know, the lawfulness is kind of delivering in some ways, I think, the calendar time on a balancing of, you know, a work-life balancing or something. So I kind of see the time limit as a sort of neoliberal flexibility policy in some ways, right? Lawfulness for this time-limited 12 weeks or equivalent is allowing people to manage their reproductive life in a way that fits into other notions of productive life. But then that's the way that you do that, you know, that has to be accountable, or law holds it to account in the sense of needing to show this slower period of reflection then, you know. And so, yeah, so it's there are multiple ways in which how time passes is managed. So by having both the speeding up and the generation of a pressurized deadline, you're, you know, accelerating the process of access, but then you decelerate right at the deadline in order to achieve, you know, some ideal of reflective time and patronize gestational labors, assuming that they haven't been reflective about it, that you need to require that by law. But yeah, so for me, that's about a legal pacing, that there's a speeding up and a slowing down, and that pacing, fast and slow, that's part of the legal process as well. And that, you know, it contributes to an unsettling, that you're not quite sure at what point the law is going to want you to be accountable to a severe deadline, as distinct from accountable to a slower reflective period.
I mean, I hate to use it's a completely trite kind of comparison, but it is a notion of hurry up and wait.
And that's
the only way for someone who obviously hasn't experienced this kind of decision making. It's the only kind of analogy I can think of.
Yeah, absolutely. Hurry up and wait. And it's all about, I mean, I think that's why I want to think more about how this way of managing reproductive time then, or making visible, I guess, how abortion law is a mechanism of managing reproductive time, that it helps us think about time. It helps us think about non-commodified time as contributing to the to social reproduction. So it's managing people's time, but just not in a commodified form. So I think that's one of the sort of broader contributions of thinking about this to materialist theory more generally, is that what's interesting about these units of legal time is they're definitely contributing to the management of reproductive labor, but they don't have to go through commodification to do that. And so, whereas a lot of the work on gestational labor has focused on commodification through surrogacy or commodification of bio labor in reproductive technologies, whereas I think the contribution that abortion law, through a category of time, the contribution it can make to thinking about bio labor and its material value is to think about the role of pregnancy and the generation of future labor power as managed in a non-commodified way. I mean, yeah, so there's...
Yeah, the other thing that I was thinking about as you were talking was trying to imagine other forms, as you were doing, trying to imagine other forms of time, other ways we think about time. And one that I thought of, which I thought, well, this is problematic, but interesting as well, is about, which comes up in the healthcare context, the notion of time as in targets and waiting list targets, and those kinds of notions of time, where the patient as consumer, do you think there's any mileage in sort of flipping around the notion of time to think of the pregnant person as the consumer who needs the provision of a service within a period of time?
Yeah, it's so interesting. Because I've been thinking, I suppose, about the way, like, we think about, as you say, targets, timely targets and waiting lists, that is the chief mechanism by which we manage, you know, the public resource of healthcare. So the distribution of healthcare is managed through these targets and these waiting lists, and becomes about, so that's a really interesting way in which we see public and state, you know, the administrative management and fair process in the administrative management of time gets articulated in that way. And so, yeah, so then I'm trying to draw out then ways in which timeliness and fairness in the distribution of time, ways in which that is speaking back to how time has been implemented at an individual level, that we don't typically see these time limits as actually imposing a normative obligation of timeliness. But I want to say that this normative obligation of timeliness has become as important as, you know, any other norm, whether it's, you know, more liberal norm around autonomy and equality, or whether it's a norm around repair and reparative justice. So the way that timeliness has become a norm at the individual level, an expectation, normative expectation of the individual, does, I think, yeah, give us opportunity to think about how we might use either, you know, consumer conceptions, as you say, and or, you know, public administrative conceptions. So yeah, fairness in the timely access. And so that's ways in which I'm thinking that the non-recognition of the stopping of the clock in pregnancy. So, you know, always we would have, when we think about fair distribution of time and resources more generally in public law, it's, you know, we'd always have a route of exceptionality for the individual. And so that the individual would always be able to make a case why they should have special access in some way to public resources. So I'm trying to think about how that individual access route, the individual funding mechanism, for example, in a healthcare context. So it doesn't have to be a market mechanism. It can still be an administered mechanism, but it's about distribution of resources. How that could be a pathway, that a legal tool that should be available to pregnant people in this instance, whose access to public health resources is being managed by not a waiting list, but by an expectation of time. And if something happens, like the failure of a medical abortion, for example, which means the clock should stop, then, yeah, they should be able to use that sort of the way interruption of the running of the clock is typically something that we use, you know, if we think in an educational context, the interrupting of the school year, of the postponing of deadlines for students' assessments, all the rest of it, all of those stopping of the clock measures are seen as part of fair administration and addressing the circumstances of that come up in people's lives. So, yeah, there's something there, all right, that I need to flesh out a bit further.
And I think that's really interesting, this idea of stopping of the clock, or the idea of the slowing of time as well. And I wondered if you'd reflected at all on the pandemic and time, and whether that, and this idea of time is having, of slowing and changing, or perhaps, and whether that has any relevance here.
Yeah, I think it's so interesting because it does. I mean, concretely, it has relevance in the sense that the way it mobilizes an emergency. So, you know, we see delivery of abortion care through telemedicine, for example, be brought into the public health service because of the pandemic. And so measures which, you know, reproductive justice advocates have been looking for a long time then get operationalized. And so the question is about how to extend them beyond this crisis pandemic moment. So, yeah, so the pandemic is interesting in ways in which it generates, the way it mobilizes crisis notions and makes certain things possible that should have been possible in non-crisis circumstances. I think it's also, yeah, really interesting in ways in which it makes the layering of different reproductive temporalities, you know, the ways in which we, of course, see, you know, who is sick and who's dying and who's brutalized by the pandemic is overlayered, of course, with existing inequalities. And so that the pandemic, you know, the way in which vulnerability is mobilized through existing inequalities, and how the pandemic exposes structural vulnerabilities is something we see when you see restricted access to relief of pregnancy and abortion law. So pandemic measures help us think about that. And then there's something about the collapsing of time, I think, time and space as well, in the ways in which movement between, you know, home spaces and workspaces or different kinds of public and private spaces, and the constant onness that, you know, has been a feature, I guess, of neoliberal time, but the way that the pandemic has kind of made that more explicit, that collapsing of different spaces and temporalities is something that we see then when you have a lack of recognition of overlapping and interactive zones of time in the way that that is coming through in periodic abortion law.
We have a question from Layla, who interesting in how it connects to what we've been talking about. Should gestational labor be paid by the state? Should it be independent of whether pregnancy is terminated at some point or not? That is, whether that labor time should be paid, whether there is a quote unquote product or not, which raises, I think, some interesting questions.
Yeah, so exactly. Just so I suppose I trying to think about this in terms of, recognizing the value. So mechanisms, public processes, which, provide everything from basic income, so I suppose that's not tied to gestational labor in particular, but I think there's probably a range of ways of drawing down public subsidy, which don't necessarily have to sort of translate into, you know, use of wage for gestational labor, but are a kind of a recognition of, just in the same way that childcare subsidies are made available, then recognizing the contribution of the future labor power to the world, and the fact that it takes resources. I think there are ways in which we could think about universal welfarist type payments that would address some of those issues. And, you know, the social reproduction literature, as it's talking about, you know, recognizing, that we need mechanisms apart from the family wage, or, you know, that makes space for the time that's needed to do this work. It's partly about just recognizing, unpacking that category of biological gestational labor and seeing it as a different kind of labor to typical productive labor, but it's something that does need recognition and support because it depletes bodily resources. And so the way that repair of that is made, I think, would take a slightly different form, but it is about, the recognition that people shouldn't be disadvantaged, at least for spending time in gestational labor.
So Ruth, do you want to give you an opportunity to talk a little bit about, situate this paper in terms of what is this kind of part of a, you're obviously you're doing a lot of thinking about these issues. So this is more the chat show kind of question. So what are you working on? Where is this going?
Well, where this is going is, I suppose, I'm thinking about ordering time. So there's a way in which I'm trying to think about how to work out from abortion law to center reproductive time in our critical categories around the generation of life, basically. So trying to join up between, you know, the work that is being doing on abortion law, trying to, I suppose, shift abortion law away from the categories around critical rights engagement to try and So partly using time to shift the framework by which we evaluate the significance of abortion's restrictions on the one hand, and then on the other hand, trying to think about centering reproductive labor and making productive labor accountable to that. So the bigger project, is looking at ordering life through time as a site of reproductive justice, is about counting, the generation of new people, the as a form of making of the future. So that's kind of at the broader, more abstract level. And then basically, though, I'm using the different pathways that I've kind of talked about today to try and map out different registers for counting time, for articulating the normative aspect of time, and for generating sort of practical micro level tools as well. So part of it is like drawing on work I have been doing with the social movement, and thinking about how we generate practical strategies for valuing not just for valuing gestational labor, but also for valuing all the work that is done in order to change the law, right? The legal labor. And so thinking about time tools then as ways of valuing all the different practices whereby people hold law to account and make it permeable and changeable. So there's there will be four chapters of the book on those four different legal pathways, but then there's also another chapter on looking at the extra legal pathways, then the sort of grey legal pathway of travel, and how exiting the time zone and using alternative time zones, how that becomes possible. And then there's the kind of the criminalised, the sort of leftover criminalised rump, and how that has a chilling effect still, I guess, in terms of that sort of criminalized pathway as well.
Well, it's interesting you mentioned travel, since obviously historically and still understanding terminations is often connected to notions of travel, to jurisdiction, as you say, to travel elsewhere. But the idea of travel is itself interestingly connected to time. So it kind of brings these things together in different ways.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's interesting because I think I've come around to this way of thinking it, having struggled with travel and movement between jurisdictions and more spatial categories as one possible option. And so, travel, thinking about how travel involves movement between different time regimes is an interesting one for sure, and how it generates, because then the practices of exiting one jurisdiction and using another, it's like this grey level of illegality in a way that becomes usable in order to work your way around restrictions. But is never fully accountable in a way that people need it to be. So follow up is difficult. There's lots of problems about a lack of accountability. But then I'm also interested in ways in which the movement between different time zones and different geographical regions, around how that movement between the pathways and the way they're materialized with support networks and practical solutions, that generates a critique then, right? Because you have the fact that the delayed access through travel becomes a way of mobilizing a critique around discrimination, for example, a critique around, not achieving legitimate objective, because you're not achieving the criminal objective of reducing abortion is not being achieved. So it can translate into legal arguments about lack of proportionality around restrictions. So yeah, so I'm interested in trying to see the connections between how these practical responses generated crisis mode kind of responses, but at the same time how they bedded down a range of alternatives and made certain critiques possible, and how that gets translated, I guess, into certain legal tools then. And so that cycle, trying to think about the way in which both the movement looking for an alternative, a transformative alternative as well, how that works through micro moments and micro practices, as well as working in, you know, broader transitional changes.
We have a question from our audience, which I'm going to reframe slightly to asking you whether you still see a role, a productive role for rights talk in the context of abortion, because your paper seemed to be moving away try to deliberately move away from the language of rights. But this is the age old question, which is, so is there still a value to rights talk, or you become disillusioned with rights in this context?
I think what I want to foreground is the ways in which people actually use rights. So there's so much work done by either, you know, activist lawyers or groups organizing, where they're using the language of rights to leverage support. And so I think there's lots of ways in which there's rights use that is not the sort of typical lawyerly assessment of proportionality or whatever it might be, right? So I'm interested in thinking about how rights have been filled out in practical material terms by those who are using them in order to unpick some of the key problems here. So I think I'm not abandoning rights at all. And I'm more interested in documenting and thinking about the actual rights uses in an everyday way, I guess. I am also interested in thinking across, you know, those more critical creative uses of them. And to thinking about, okay, how does that generate resources for us then when we make legal arguments? We do see, I think it's interesting how in Northern Ireland, for example, we got greater engagement with Article 8 rights by the Northern Irish High Court in a context where the Attorney General was very conservative, but the courts, you know, the kind of splits between the different elements of the legal infrastructure meant that the High Court engaged with a substantive notion of the right to private and family life when the Human Rights Commission were bringing that challenge to the restrictiveness and the non-access in cases of rape and in cases of fetal abnormality. So I think there's something, it's very hard it's not about documenting causal relationships, but there are ways in which certain activist and support group impacts and ways in which restrictions and the sort of chilling environment as well together have an impact, which means that certain institutional legal actors become a bit more adventurous perhaps in how they engage substantively. And so I think there's something about unpacking and making more of some of those legal interventions. So, and I think also it's partly because I want to, it's this thing about working the micro moments and the micro practices with the larger transitions. So trying to hold on to a sense that, yeah, we want of course, to have a transformative justice and to see, to have the value of reproductive labor and gestational labor taken seriously and to, you know, work towards no restrictions. But on the way to doing that, that it doesn't have to be, you know, that we see smaller changes as antithetical to the struggle for larger changes or more structural changes. So I'm trying to think about the relationship, yeah, between those micro moments and the larger changes. And, you know, I think that's what we're seeing at the moment in reproductive justice movements, labor movements around, you know, one of us, all of us, connecting up. You know, and the Argentinian feminists are really good at articulating this in the and in visualizing it as, you know, millions take to the street. And it is about that linking of the micro moment that is possible for of participation that is possible for an individual, that whatever you can do, that micro moment is significant in the overall struggle. And we through joining up all those micro practices and micro moments of engagement, we can use the joining up of all those moments to overcome and transform things more generally. So, yeah, so it's trying to work at that level of not seeing things in terms of either transformative change or, you know, rights-based change, but thinking about how they're actually used in cooperative ways together.
Well, I think that's a fantastic point on which to draw this to a close, which really, I think, brilliantly pulls together this work. So I'd like to thank you, Ruth, for joining us today, for presenting, you know, a really exciting, rich, multi-layered paper. So many thanks for taking the time to share it with us. And thank you as well to our audience for joining us and for your participation. Our next seminar in the Director Series will be on the 26th of January at 0900 GMT. And I hope you will join me then. So thank you, Ruth.
Thanks very much, Carl. I really enjoyed it.
Thank you, everyone. So until we meet again, it's goodbye from the Institute of Advanced Legal Studies in London. Goodbye for now.